Hear the sopranos.
Sin upon
Amen. Amen. Let's continue to praise our amazing God. We're going to sing Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here.
Amen. Please go ahead and be seated.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Big Apple Church. We are so happy to have you with us, whether you are a member, first-time visitor, or watching with us online. We're so glad to have you all with us this morning as we celebrate Palm Sunday. It is a beautiful day to be here. And over the last few weeks, Sophie, my beautiful wife, and myself, Chris, have just had a great time learning about the Book of Revelation in our What If series. And so last week we capped off that series, and Sophie wanted to just share one of the things that stuck out to her from that series as we start our morning.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Ross, lost track of where you are, for your sermon last week. What a great way to finish Revelations. Okay. Oh, sorry. You talked about Revelations 21, verse 1 through 4, that said, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth." I'm going to skip to verse 3. "God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be with his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." So as I was reading this verse, one of the things I thought about was home, and Ross's, the whole theme of it was recalibrating where home was to us. And so for me, I am not born in America. I came here back in 2018, and Cambodia is home for me. And, you know, every once in a while, I'll think about home and going back home and missing home and all the differences between America and Cambodia. And one of the encouraging things about this verse is how it talks about, despite, you know, wherever we may be in life, God will always be our sameness, our something that we can always rely on, our stability, and looking forward to the new home and our eternal home. And so, you know, it was a reminder for me that no matter where I am, whether it's Cambodia or America, God remains the one true home and the one true stability that I have despite all the changes. And what's so awesome is that, you know, as I was thinking about home this week, a part of home actually came to visit, and he's actually sitting here today, and he's part of the ICOC Church in California. And so it was such a blessing to be able to kind of see this verse and then see a friend, a familiar face that I knew. And, you know, it's so awesome because as I'm here, I've also been given the opportunity to serve the people in New York City and also call this place home now as well.
And we're just so thankful for all of the different people that we've gotten to meet in this church to help New York City feel more like home. It was almost a year ago that John married us in Central Park. So we're about to have our one-year anniversary, and we're just so thankful for all of you. And so as we set our eyes forward on this week, we've got Good Friday on Friday, an amazing worship service coming up, and Easter on Sunday. And so as we set our eyes on Holy Week, please just bow your heads with me, and let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you so much for just this amazing location where we can come together and we can worship together. We can praise all of the amazing things about you, God, about your goodness and your grace and your magnificence. And Lord, we're just so thankful that you sent your son, Jesus, to die on the cross for us, to conquer death, to conquer sin, and to rise victorious. And we're just so thankful to celebrate these themes. And Lord, I just want to pray for those who are sick and those who aren't able to come out here today. We pray that you will watch over them and their families. God, specifically, we want to pray over Gabriel, whose grandmother passed away and they had that funeral yesterday. We pray that you will just bring comfort and peace to that family during this time. And Lord, for all of us who are struggling or have loved ones that are in a tough place, Lord, we pray that you will watch over us and that you will lift us up, and that we will praise you for all the things that you've taken us out of in the past and all the amazing things you're going to do in the future. We lift all these things up to you, and we bring them before your son, Jesus, and in his name we pray, amen. Amen. Thank you.
deserve the glory.
Father God, we come before you humble, thankful for who you are, God. God, thank you for your power. Thank you for your way to transform us, God. We come here leaving every burden and just bowing down at your feet to worship you. And it is in your Son's name that we pray this. Amen. Praise, worthy of our lives, Father. We are grateful to be able to hear, to offer up everything to you. God, I pray as we continue on with this service, with our lives, we're able to just edify you with everything that we do, with every breath that we have, with every word that we say. Lord, thank you for giving us the gift of life and having us here today. We love you. In your Son's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We're going to sing one more song before John Markowski comes up to preach the word. We're going to have a little fun. So here we go. Let's go ahead and sing Praise.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise when I'm sure, I praise when I'm doubting, I praise when I'm numbered, I praise when surrounded. Praise is the waters our enemies drown in. More than a sound. My praise. the Lord, oh my soul. I won't be quiet, I won't be quiet. My God is alive, how could I keep it inside?
We're gonna go the bridge.
I praise 'cause you're sovereign, praise 'cause you reign, praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise 'cause you're faithful, praise 'cause you're true, praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you.
Go ahead and have a seat.
Right. Awesome. All right.
Let everything.
Stays with you. I love it. Good morning, everybody. It's great to be with you. Great to be worshiping with you. Great to be together in this place. This is a pretty big week, not just in the Christian world, but in the religious world at large. With the lunar and Gregorian calendars overlapping, and throw in leap day and the spring equinox, we have all kinds of overlaps happening in the major religions. Ramadan, which is the holiest of the Muslim months, started mid-March and ends in a couple of weeks. Purim is today, the Jewish holiday that celebrates the story of Esther and liberation from oppression and the threat of genocide. Today is also Palm Sunday, as mentioned earlier. And this is, if you didn't know, a Christian holiday that begins the Passion Week leading up to Easter. And it's interesting, almost 60% of the globe is either Christian, Jew, or Muslim, and they're all taking time today to spend some special moments in reflection, in memorialization, in fasting, and in prayer. And I just think it cannot be lost on us that during these sacred days, there are still the horrors of violence in our world, particularly in the Holy Land. So what I would like to do right now is just have a moment of silent prayer for peace. So let's get comfortable and just close our eyes for a minute and meditate on that. Amen. It's heavy. And I thank you for doing that with me. Sometimes I just want to come to church and forget about everything that's happening outside these walls and just focus on the hope and the happy and the faith and the love. But we're called by Scripture to care deeply for our world. So we've got to do our best to find that balance between empathy and the pain of empathy, but also vision and the hope of that vision. So we pray the prayer like I have on the screen here of Zechariah in Luke 1:79, guide our feet into the path of peace. Let's all say that together in unison. Guide our feet into the path of peace. It's a good one to remember each morning. You know, we begin our Easter Bible study series today. We're not just going to celebrate Easter next Sunday, but we're going to talk about it today and next Sunday, and then all of April. We're going to talk about Jesus leading up to the cross and during his resurrection and some of the experiences that he had recorded in the final chapters of the Gospel of Luke, and just live into that reality, because in essence, this is what Christianity is about. And so if we're not talking about this and these chapters and really the crux of the whole story, then everything else makes a little less sense. So we're going to make it make more sense. And I'm going to give you a little preview here for the next few weeks. And you can see what we're going to be doing here. Palm Sunday is today. We'll do Easter is going to be amazing next week, all right? There's going to be all kinds of different stuff happening here in this room, outside of this room, downstairs with the kids. There's going to be a lot of fun, and we're really going to worship God, and hopefully a lot of friends will join us, as typically happens around this time of year. We'll continue part three on the road as we get into Luke 24, Faith on Fire. That's going to be on April 14th. The marrieds will be at a married retreat out of town, and so this will be an all-edge singles-led service right here in the Time Center, which will be very exciting here. And then on April 21st, we'll continue with Luke 24, The Last Meal, and then close it out at the beginning of the book of Acts, which is written by the same author as the Gospel of Luke, A Future Kingdom Now. All right, you ready for this?
Yeah.
All right. For the 11 of us that are ready, here we go. All right. Luke 19. You're welcome to look in your Bibles or follow along on the screen. We're going to read this text about what we've been singing about and talking about all morning, this triumphal entry on what we call Palm Sunday. Luke 19, starting in verse 28. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethpage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you'll find a colt tied there, which no one's ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you why you're untying it, say the Lord needs it. Let me just do a little footnote. This does not apply to all situations. You don't go to people and take something and say the Lord needs it. This is just for this specific time and purpose in the Bible. You with me here? All right, not a justification for kleptomania. We'll keep moving. Verse 32, those who were sent ahead and went and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, why are you untying the colt? Just like he said. And what happens? They said, the Lord needs it. And I guess that worked. All right, they brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. Verse 36, as he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, teacher, rebuke your disciples. I tell you, he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. Let everything, even that doesn't have breath. All right. This story is in all four Gospels, Matthew 21, Mark 11, Luke 19 here, and in John chapter 12. When it's in all four of the accounts of Jesus, we pay a little closer attention, right? Now, we're describing here this procession, this bunch of people lined on either side of the road, Jesus coming down, and people are kind of cheering for him, like a parade. So raise your hand if you've ever been part of a parade, in a parade, watching a parade, live, either on television. Okay, all right, most of us, all right? Try to keep saying things so we get more participation. All right, here we go. So everyone is aware of the word parade and what it means and all that. So for those of you who have had experiences either watching it live or being in one, we're going to have a little audience participation. Just raise your hand and tell me one thing you remember, one thing that was maybe a highlight or something that really sticks out in your mind about the parade. Just be real quick. Yeah.
The costumes.
The costumes. That's huge, right? Yeah, Linda?
The floats.
The floats. Yes. Mike? A gathering of so many people in one place, yeah.
Firefighters throwing candy.
What's that parade? Okay, I definitely want to go to that parade. I love that parade, yes.
All the famous people on the floats.
Famous people, celebrities on the floats, yeah.
Drums.
Drums, yes, we love the drums, yes.
The
band, yeah. Did you have one too, Carmela? The same. Look at this married couple just having the same thought together in the same moment. I love it, Tamu. All right, the beads. Yes, Charlie.
I rode on a tank. I was 10 years old.
Charlie rode on a tank in a parade when he was 10 years old. Should we end it after that? Okay, I don't know. All right. Do we have more on this side? Yeah. Go ahead.
Energy.
The energy. Yes.
Joy.
The joy. All right. Any more?
Santa Claus!
All right, Lamont, last one.
Balloons.
Balloons, yes. All right, are we in the spirit of a parade now? Are we feeling it? All right, we are not going to go out to 42nd Street and have a parade. We're going to stay in here right now. But hopefully you're in the spirit, all right? You're thinking about Macy's or a sports event or the different thing you went to in your high school, the parade, the energy, the joy. So Jesus' entry into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday has some similarities with the things that we just shared and also some differences. Part of the same thing, you can already tell, right? The crowd, there's some central focus, right? Someone said celebrities or balloons. In this case, it's Jesus, no balloons, all right? You're thinking about joy and praise, loud voices, a crowd. Also, no one mentioned this, but sometimes there's drama at parades, right? The little skirmishes happening. Some people don't want the parade. We have that right here. The Pharisees do not want what's going on. Stop that. Rebuke them. Tell them to be quiet, right? Now, what are some differences? Well, we're going to dig into that and dig into the Roman history to understand the context of what was happening when a procession like this took place so we can dig into what the differences are and why Jesus' triumphal entry on Palm Sunday is different. So, a little bit of history here. In Republican Rome, the triumphal procession was a very big deal, all right? A general would come back after a big war, a big battle, or an emperor is coming into town, and they would throw this huge party parade. It's one of the highest possible honors to get is this triumphal entry, all right? There are epic legends of tropes like this, Alexander, even legends of Hercules coming back to the whole city, just going crazy for their hero. The honoree would usually wear a purple toga and a laurel crown. They'd ride in on a war stallion or sometimes a chariot with many horses, like the image we have here in this ancient relief. It was a long and slow process, usually lasting 3 days. They also would open up all the temples so that everyone could worship all their different gods at the time in Roman culture. There were captives and plunder in the tow of the parade, meaning that if a warrior went out and led Rome to victory, they would take slaves sometimes, and they would steal all their stuff, plunder, and loot the city. Very violent thing that the Romans were about. And then they would have them in the end of the parade so everyone can see how powerful Rome was. Pretty disgusting stuff. There was military marching. There were entertainment and games going on just for this hero. And also there were flawless white oxen that were led to the Temple of Jupiter for sacrifice as part of the Roman cult. And finally, they would end on this hill where the Temple Jupiter was. All right, do you already see where I'm going here? See, Jesus flips the script on a traditional triumphal entry. And I want to point out, I know we talked about this a little bit in the past, This will be different. I want to point out three interesting differences, and then we'll sort of zoom out at the end to compare Jesus' entry with this thing in Roman history that everybody knew about. All right, here we go. I want to talk about the colt, the clothes, and the cries. In Luke 19 and verse 30, it says you're going to find a colt there, which no one has ever ridden. Now, this is from prophecy in the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures, in Zechariah 9:9. And I'll just read it. It says, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Now, Rome. Rome is the world, all right? Leaders and war generals coming back. Remember the parade. It's all about their earthly power. Does Jesus come in the same kind of power? No. In fact, Jesus almost comes in the opposite, powerlessness. No boasting, no war horse, no chariot, no military, right? But on a what? On a humble donkey. Never ridden, inexperienced, maybe a little wobbly. We don't know all the details about the particular colt that was saved for him, but never ridden before. That's how Jesus entered. As we think spiritually about how this applies to us, I want us to ask ourselves, how do we enter the world? How do we enter the room? Even today, how did you enter the time center? What was your demeanor? What were you feeling? What were you thinking? What were you worried about? Or what's it like when you walk into work on Monday or sign in remotely on Monday? How are you when you show up with your friends? Is it the same as work or church, or is it different? Or with family? Are you perceived more like a war general coming in with all your boasts and all your bests? Or are you coming in like Jesus? You know, as children of God, we're called to be humble, to give up the desire for earthly power because we're secure in who we are and the way God made us. Not to leverage our entitlements for selfish gain, but to give selflessly, to be kind without expectation in return. Now, I'm not saying you can't walk into a room confident, but there's a difference between confidence and arrogance. Amen? Now, sometimes it's difficult to have that spiritual security when we feel like stuff's falling apart around us. Careers might be stuck. We've got conflicts with people that we're close to. We're going through losses. We're grieving different things. And sometimes we're just not so sure it's all going to work out. You been there? That's hard. That's real. That can change the way you enter the spaces that you live. But let me tell you something. Find security in something bigger than yourself. When you base your faith and confidence on yourself, you're going to get caught on the roller coaster of ego. And the ego is fragile and unpredictable. You know what I'm saying? Instead, we're about drawing on the security of God, because you know what God is not? God is not fragile, and God is constant. You know, I've always been a pretty confident person. I had confident parents. My mom is here, and I have imitated her spirit in life. Not arrogance, but confidence. We held our heads up even when we were broke pretty much most of my childhood, from what I can remember. I remember begging for things, and it was always a no, even ice cream. But no, every now and then I get some ice cream. Mom was a good mom. We wore donated clothes. We drove cars that were given to us, held together by
duct tape.
Thank you very much. We did not rehearse that. That's just the truth. And at a young age, I didn't think about being embarrassed about stuff like that. That came later when my heart got corrupted by the world. It reminds me of the preview for the new Pixar film, Inside Out, the sequel, where like new things are being introduced in adolescence, like shame and embarrassment. I don't know. Have you seen that preview? But at that age, before I hit that element in my life, it always just felt like a great adventure. Our car was held together by tape, and one time we were leaving a parking lot, and the door that I was sitting by in the back seat flew wide open, and I went flailing out. And if it wasn't for the seatbelt, I would be run over by the tires of that station wagon. Yes, it was crazy. swinging out there and coming back in. But when I came back and everything was good, I didn't say, man, life stinks, we need a new car. I said, oh, I'm so grateful to be alive. We got to train our spiritual attitudes to be like the trusting child again. But not to trust cars or jobs or people or parents, but you should trust your parents, but on our divine parent in heaven. You know what I mean? The priority, the anchor, the compass, the way we live our lives. No, we're not war generals taking over division at work, but we can act like that sometimes. Oh, here he comes. Oh, here she comes. Watch out. What kind of reputation do you have? We're not conquering relationships. We're not trying to make others look bad so we can look good. That's not the way we live. No, it's the opposite. We bring joy to our jobs, and it's right to work hard and earn a wage. We lift up our coworkers. We welcome in new people. We decide we're not going to be threatened. And we speak to people directly, not with rumors and gossip. We don't build relationships or date to conquer someone. We don't date or build relationships to achieve something. We date to encourage. We build friendships to encourage. We date to selflessly serve somebody. And if you're looking for love, amen. Guess what? That's the actual definition of love, to selflessly serve somebody. We ride in on a lowly donkey, people. Not with flash, not with bling, not with filters, but just true and authentically us. Holding our head high, because we're right with God and we hope that others can be as well. Let's remember the words of James 4:10. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Point number two, close. Luke 19:36, we read it before. It says, as he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. Now, in the Roman parade, in the Roman triumphal procession, they cleared the roads for these things, right? But not with peasant cloaks and dirty farm clothing. They got the red carpet treatment. They sectioned off the roads. You could see in the map I had earlier where they mark the actual route, just like they do with the Macy's parade and stuff like that. And everybody knew what was going on. It was heavily guarded. No one walks on the road. That's the red carpet treatment, the royal treatment that they got. What does Jesus come in on? What's his red carpet treatment? You know, like the shirts off of people's backs. Right? You ever put your clothes on the ground? My wife is cringing right now because New York can get a little dirty. How many people have a policy that when they come into your home, they take their shoes off? All right. Now, we're not going to talk about the reasons why. But if you lived in New York City for any length of time, you know that there are certain landmines that exist throughout the city. And just because it rained last night doesn't mean it's all gone. There's some residue. Anyway, I said we were not going to get into it, and here I am talking about it. There are certain people, like my wife, that say, listen, even when we're on the subway car, do not let the bags touch the floor. All right, amen. Yeah, listen, she's not alone, and I know that. I'm in the minority here. I'm like, I'm okay if the grocery bag touches the ground, but when I'm with her, it doesn't happen. Don't you know what could have been on that floor? Okay, we understand it. Kick it dirty on the ground. You know, we used to play soccer in empty parking lots and fields all over upstate New York. Just me and a bunch of people that we played with. And oftentimes we wouldn't have like goalposts. We didn't have nets. Now they have those little fold-up things that pop up anywhere you want to play. Those are great. We didn't have those back then. And so we just used whatever we had on us to create goals. Usually it was shirts. Or a bag, or, you know, whatever you had on you. And you knew that your stuff was going to get trampled on, the ball was going to go over, cleats were going to step on you, mud all over your stuff, probably going to get yelled at by your mom when you get home. Like, what happened, all right? But it didn't matter, because for the sake of the game, for the fellowship, for the sport, for the fun, if you had anything extra on you, you were going to put it in. And if you didn't, if you had, like, a bag on the side, You would get yelled at for being selfish. Like, what? Why is your bag over there? That could be a goalpost. Bring that over here. I don't want it to get dirty. What? What are you talking about? Don't even understand that. All right, so here we are, talking about the ground being dirty and stuff. What would you give the shirt off your back for? All right, what situations in life call you to risk putting something on the ground? In other words, what's a worthy sacrifice? What do you sacrifice for? The Lippincotts and us were recently at a church conference this last week, and a minister shared about meeting a brother from Africa. And he told the brother from Africa, man, I love the top you're wearing. What a cool shirt. Didn't even know what to call it. It was like all this like native design and silk fabric and beautiful. And the next day, he saw the brother again, and the African brother came up to him and had a little bag and basically gave him the shirt that he was wearing. And his brother from America, you know, we're not used to that kind of a cultural hospitality. Right. He was blown away. He's blown away. You know, I hope that when we think about our top priorities, our list of worthy sacrifices, I hope that this right here, the church, is somewhere in the top of your list. Isn't this a worthy sacrifice? To invest into this community, right? We're here, right? We're not just spectators. We're here because we invest in this as our church family, our community. It's what we do. You know, Jose had a birthday yesterday, and many of us went, and there were people from the neighborhood. People, I mean, I felt like all of New York was represented in this little place. And Jose, if you know Jose Rivera, you just know this is the kind of humble man that when he says, I'm doing a little thing, everybody shows up. And we were all packed in this little room and just having a great time. And people, family came in, and some of them are here today. And it's like, that's what we're talking about. That's a worthy sacrifice. A group of people that you love. A group of people that you want to invest in. That's the church. You know, we're in tax season right now. Interest rates are ridiculous. Is your rent going up? I know mine is. We got a charity event on Friday. We have special contribution coming up. If you don't know what that is, once a year, we do a special time where we give extra money to our sister congregations in Africa and the Caribbean and all around New York. You say, why do we do this after tax time, John? There's never a good time to give money. But let me talk to the members of the church here real quick. You know, our contribution, we've been talking about it, and I know COVID has been hard hitting, and I know a lot of things have happened. But ultimately, a lot of our members are deciding to give less or not at all. And I'm not talking about exorbitant amount of money. I'm talking anything, even a few dollars. Consider what is a worthy sacrifice for you. Maybe there are reasons, maybe there's no reason. Let me make an appeal regardless of your situation. The church is never perfect, but the bride of Christ is always worth it. This will never be a perfect church. If that's your goal, well, please don't leave now. You can leave after the service is done. But it's never going to be perfect. The sermons will not always be amazing. Maybe you're feeling like that's happening right now. It's not that great. And I'm okay with that. Are you okay with that? Because no family is perfect. But you know what is perfect? Imperfection. Because it's real. Say, yeah, I know we have flaws. It's something we can work on. It's something we can work on. You know, that this is just more than a community. This is Christ incarnate inside of us. It's a second chance from our sins, and it's a lease on eternity. Put your shirt on the ground for Jesus. And let's remember what's really important. Finally, cries. Luke 19:40. Like it said when we read it earlier, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. The Roman parades, I mean, they would go crazy. I mean, loud. When someone wins a Super Bowl, or we lived in L.A. for many years, and the Lakers just kept winning over and over and over again. It was just kind of annoying. And the whole, everything would close down. You get a day off of work, the parades, the celebrities, everybody's there, and oh, man, it was so cool. We're watching it. But if you're down there in downtown, is deafening, the cries. So loud. And that was for their hero, for conquering the Roman enemies. You know, it's crazy. You think about all the places that Rome conquered. And there's, you know, statues everywhere. You can read about it. It was an ugly business of colonialism, going around just wiping people out. Anyone that stood in the way of Roman power, they dominated. Now, I tell you, if someone found out, if you're a Roman citizen, maybe living in Rome, you're getting propaganda, all right? You're getting only one channel of news, and that's whatever the Roman Empire decides to tell you. So what they tell you is, these are all enemies, they're going to attack us, they're going to kill us, so we need to kill them before they kill us. That's the news, right? So you're like, yes, when the hero comes back, that's our survival. Yeah. Okay, you with me? Yeah. That's the only news channel on, all right? If they were to find out about the horrors of Roman colonialism, they might have changed their mind and stopped applauding. Who knows? But guess what would have happened if one or two people decide to stop applauding? Another 1,000 will take their place. That's the mob, right?
Right?
When everyone's into something, it's really difficult to turn that tide. Now, with God, we're called to offer our praise, our worship, our loud voices, right? And one way we do that, knowing the truth and getting the source from the scriptures to tell us what's really going on, one way we do that is we sing, right? Now, I know not everyone loves to sing. A lot of this group loves to sing. But, you know, it's not for everyone. You know, we're not all growing up singing harmonies with our family. I remember singing with my family at church growing up when we were little. And not everyone has that experience. I remember when I showed up to church the first time, people were looking at me, how do you know all the words to the songs? Now, I knew a lot of them because we grew up going to different churches, but the other ones are pretty easy to pick up. And I grew up singing, so pretty easy. Arlene was always shocked. She always thought I was lying, like doing homework on my own before I came to church to learn all the words of the song. I'm like, no, I just know these songs. That's not everybody, and I get that. I get that some people come to church for the first time, like, I'm not singing. That's not my thing, and that's okay. If you're with us for the first time, there's no obligation to sing. Just enjoy the beautiful voices around you. Whether they're in key or not, doesn't matter. Of course, it's your right to do what you want. But if it's because, especially those who have been around a little while, if it's because you don't feel like it, or because, well, I'm not a trained singer, why should I be singing? Let me encourage you. There's a difference between performance and participation. Imagine you're at a concert with your favorite band. I'm pretty sure you're singing. Probably yelling. No matter how bad you sound, or another example, you're in the shower, nobody knows. There's no audience, but you're belting it out. All right? See, at some point, your joy in the participation overwhelms your insecurity about performance. The Bible says there are times we should be quiet, but there are other times when we should speak up, sing out loud, praise our God. And if we don't, somehow nature itself will fill the void. But that's not a reason not to sing. That's a reason to sing. You know, I went out to meet my son on Friday night. We were going to go hang out. I was just walking down 25th Street, minding my own business. And I could hear, as often happens, around 10 o'clock at night, some yelling down the road. And, you know, you can decipher different yelling, kind of like a parent can decipher when a baby's cry is like, I'm hurt, or I'm hungry, or I've, you know, gone to the bathroom. You can decipher those cries. No parents do that? Yes, I know you do that. So in New York, a New Yorker, if you don't know, you can decipher the different kind of screams. Like, okay, someone's getting hurt there, or someone's just, you know, had a little bit too much, or, you know. So this one I couldn't figure out. And it was about a half a block down, and I'm kind of peering down the block. What kind of screaming is this? And as I got closer to the source, it went quiet. And there's a few people walking towards me, and I thought, uh-oh. What's about to happen? Am I going to get a surprise screamer? First two people pass, no screaming. I'm almost to the subway. And then a guy just walking, you know, minding his own business. I get to be about 5 feet. He's coming one direction. I'm coming the other. And all of a sudden, he takes a step towards me and starts screaming. It was him. I found him. Now, as New Yorkers, you're trained to keep it moving. You assess the threat, and you try to keep it moving. And then there wasn't a threat. He didn't take more than a step towards me. But here's what he said. And it was as clear as anything I've ever heard in my life. He said, "You're a worldly man. Don't you see? It's time to grow up." This is no lie. 9:58 p.m. I'm telling you, Friday evening, 25th Street and 8th Avenue. "You're a worldly man. Don't you see? It's time to grow up." Whoa, and then he kept walking. I don't know what he was saying earlier, but it wasn't that. What was going on? Man, I was stunned. I kept it moving. I got in the train, but I was thinking about that for like 20, 30 minutes. I've heard it all in the city. You have too, right? You've heard it all. But I've never been addressed like that. So clear. I thought, well, it's just a wild man screaming in the street. And then my other mind said, that's what they said about John the Baptist. And then I went, oh, well, come on, John. You don't believe that there's truth in things like that. Come on, you just keep it moving. And then I thought, but am I a worldly man? Am I blind? Do I need to grow up? Now, pause for a second. I'm not saying every Big Apple screamer is a prophet speaking spiritual truth. Here's what I am saying. Truth can come from anywhere. Even the stones will cry out. And I want to be the kind of person that can accept truth from anywhere and anyone, regardless of the circumstances. There are ways that I'm worldly. I can be blind. There are things I need to grow up in. Amen. What are the stones telling you? And what will they scream if you don't? As we compare the two triumphal entries, you can see it clearly. Jesus, he was speaking a new language. He was bringing a new truth and a new triumph. Not the purple toga and the laurel crown, but a purple robe of mockery that had put on him as he went to the cross, and a thorn crown. Not on a war stallion, but a young donkey never ridden. Long and slow 3 days of parade? No, it was a 3-day long, slow, excruciating process of execution. All the godless temples were open in Rome for the triumphal procession, but the temple curtain was torn in two during Jesus' death. Instead of the captives in tow, Jesus himself is the captive and the plunder of the passion. There is no angel army backing up Jesus, even though it's on call if he wants it, but he says no to that power. There's no entertainment, no games. So Christ himself is the flawless lamb led to sacrifice. And while his passion procession ends on a hill called Golgotha, his ultimate end comes in the form of an empty tomb and a heavenly ascent. This is our Lord. He's different than any other leader to ever live. And he calls us to be like him. How will you enter Easter? Palm Sunday gives us an opportunity to start this week thinking about how we enter the spaces of our lives and how we want to enter in on Sunday, 7 days from now, and celebrate the crux of our belief, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Palm Sunday is about remembering humility, like Jesus, who rode in confident to Jerusalem, but not worldly prestige or power, but in humble confidence. It's about sacrifice, that God gave his life for us, and we respond by giving back to help the church flourish. And it's about the participation of praise, not the performance for praise. This is what we think about on Palm Sunday in preparation for resurrection. As we close, I want to read this final passage and then pray for the communion at this time. In 2 Corinthians 2:14, it says, "But thanks be to God, who always leads us as captives in Christ's triumphal procession and uses us to spread the aroma of the knowledge of him everywhere." Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to be alive, to learn, to be beings who can grow up, who can mature, who can see our blind spots, who can fight against the influences of all the world and instead hold on to the anchor that you provide. God, thank you for the opportunity this week to think about ourselves introspectively, how we enter the world, how we enter the spaces, how we can give in humility, give back to the church, and to cry out in praise to inspire others to do the same. God, thank you for changing our lives. Thank you for forgiving us and redeeming us from our past and for promising a great future. Father, we take the emblems of the communion right now, the bread and the cup, which reminds us of the blood that Jesus shed, the body that was crucified on the cross, but even more importantly, the resurrection on the third day. Thank you for your life and for your love. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
spat upon the Savior, so pure and free from sin. They said, crucify him, he's to blame. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. Upon his precious head, they placed a crown of thorns. They laughed and said, struck him and they cursed him and mocked his holy name. All alone he suffered everything. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the
Amen. That concludes our time of communion today. And let's go ahead and thank John Markowski for an excellent message. Thank you, John. Really appreciate that. And I love that idea that John was talking about, which is how do we enter into places? And I think that's such a great question for us to consider as representatives of Jesus, that last scripture, that we are the aroma of Christ, that we get to spread the scent of Jesus around with the people around us. And so how do we enter, whether it's work, whether it's when we come back home from work with our kids or our families or our spouses, how are we when we enter church? And when we're around each other, do we come as a conqueror? Do we come humble like Jesus? And I really appreciated that thought. So again, a lot to think about there. That was great. I want to give us a few announcements as we close out today, just a couple reminders. The first thing I want to let us know about is that there is a small group leaders meeting today downstairs in the hall right after service. So there's a small group leaders meeting today right after service. If you're a small group leader, just remember to head down there pretty soon. And parents, please pick up your children right after the last song so that we can clear the hall. Also, there is a worship team rehearsal for Easter in this room right after service. So if we could take our fellowship out into the lobby as soon as service ends, that would be great. Also, you know why you want to go out to the lobby right after service ends? is because there's a youth and family bake sale that's going to be happening. So again, please consider grabbing a cupcake for camp or a brownie or whatever there is out there. It's great that we are able to support our youth and help as a fundraiser to send them to summer camp, which we know the theme already is going to be a great summer camp. I won't tell you just yet, but it's going to be amazing. Also, I want to remind us, I know it's been talked about and talked about, guys, it's almost here, our Amplify worship night. It's going to be this coming Friday. And we're very, very excited about it. And today we got a little taste of a song. We're going to do that song, Worthy of It All. That's going to be one that we're going to be doing this coming Friday. But I do want to make one last pitch or request of you. We do have 137 tickets left. There's 215 tickets sold, and it's pretty amazing. We'd love to see the house packed. So please consider coming if you haven't already gotten a ticket or inviting someone you know to come. We'd love to see people who are not a part of our church community come out and experience what it's like. Remember from last week to hear a little taste of heaven. The other thing, though, that I'd like to make a plug for is that for some of us, maybe we're going to be traveling, going to see family, we're going to be away for Easter weekend. I want to ask you, please consider donating as well. That's an option. You can donate, and as long as for anybody who donates at least $10, we're going to be sending out the live stream link. It's going to be a private link. It won't be public, but you'll be able to watch. And so I just want to ask, consider donating because it is something we're giving the net proceeds to Chance for Africa. There's some small expenses. It'd be great if we could cover that and be able to just give as much as we can to Chance for Africa. So again, please consider, even if you're not coming in person, consider making a donation. That would be amazing. Also, we're going to have a marriage retreat. So for our married couples, there is a marital fiction. And so that's going to be in April. And so please don't let money be an obstacle to getting tickets for that, married couples. Let us know how we can support. If you really want to come, it's going to be an amazing time as we invest in our marriages. And finally, Easter is next Sunday. And so let's bring our friends, our family, our neighbors. We're going to have the welcome wagon out in force in the lobby. So come on, welcome wagon. And they'll be out there for our visiting guests and for this very special service as we honor the miracle of the resurrection. So it's going to be a great time next Sunday. Let's go ahead and stand and close out with one final song.
Turn around the world. heard around the
fellowship.